Welcome to our Football Officials video training series. We're studying the National Federation of High School rules and five-man mechanics. This video is produced by the Arkansas Association of High School Officials. We're helping good officials get better. Technical assistance provided by Dax Hill, Greg Downham, and George Demetrio. Our producer is Matt Bibbin. Executive producer is Walt Coleman. And I'm your host, Todd Allen. All right, we're going to start this week off with a little different play. This play is an NCAA, and we're going to begin to incorporate more and more of NCAA plays and NFL plays for a couple of different reasons. One, they're categorized real easily so that we can find plays that particularly emphasize a point that we want to make. The second reason is the video quality is superior, and you can get a better understanding of what we're talking about. We're still only going to talk about the National Federation of High School rules, and we're only going to talk about five-man mechanics. We're just going to use these videos for those two reasons. All right, so the first thing I want to talk about before we look at this play, and this is a play from week one in the Illinois-Nebraska game, but I want to talk about the momentum rule, particularly where we talk about the momentum rule in 8-5-2. And let's just take a look at that real quickly. And it just says that it is a safety when a runner carries the ball from the field of play to or across his own goal line and becomes dead there in his team's possession. And the momentum rule comes in when we start talking about the exception here. When a defensive player intercepts an opponent's forward pass, intercepts or recovers an opponent's fumble or backward pass, or an R player catches or recovers a scrimmage kick or free kick between his 5-yard line and the goal line, and his original momentum carries him into the end zone where the ball remains in the end zone and is declared dead in the end zone in his team's possession, or it goes out of bounds in the end zone, the ball belongs to the team in possession at the spot where the fumble or pass was intercepted or recovered, or the kick was caught or recovered. That's very, very important. So a couple of things I want to point out here. I want to point out this covers some very specific plays, and it all involves recovering or catching an opponent's ball. So just for an example, we're inside the 5-yard line and we're coming out, and Team A fumbles the ball and a lineman runs and scoops the ball up, and his original momentum carries him into the end zone where he is tackled. The momentum rule would not cover that play because he recovered his teammate's fumble, not an opponent's fumble. So the word opponent in this exception is very, very important, not relevant to this play that I want to talk about now. And forget this official right here because we don't have that on a five-man crew. But let's talk about the position of the back judge on this scrimmage kick. He is straddling the goal line, which is a great position to be in. On a five-man crew, you're going to have the goal line and the end line as well, so you've got to be flexible and make sure that you can cover both of those. But on this play, very, very important. The other thing that I want to point out is having a beanbag in your hand on a scrimmage kick play if you're a back judge or a line judge, because you're going to want to mark the end of the kick. The end of the kick on this play is just when a player gains possession of the kick, because we know when that happens, the kick rules are off and we just have a running play. If the player is a receiving team player, then we just have a run. If the player is a kicking team player, then we have the end of the down, because the ball becomes dead by rule if a kicking team player gains possession of a ball and the status of the ball is still a kick. So on a muff, where the receiving team muffs the ball and the status is still a kick, if that ball goes across or breaks the plane of the goal line, it's a touchback. Or if that ball is recovered by Team K, it is dead by rule because Team K has recovered the kick. So in this play, back judge, I'm just going to run it here real slow. As soon as this player gains possession of the ball about the 2-yard line, you should toss the beanbag onto the field of play at the 2-yard line. And that just lets you know that you are working a possible momentum play. And then we look at this play right here, and look at this player's left knee. This left knee is on the ground. So we've got a player in high, now we're thinking about, this is high school rule. Now this is not a kick into the end zone because this player gained possession of the ball at the 2-yard line, so the kick rules end, and now we've got a running play. So we've got a Team R player taking the ball into his end zone, which without the exception of the momentum rule, if his knee goes down like this player's does, it would just be dead and it would be a safety. But because we have the momentum rule, this ball becomes dead right here when this player's knee touches the ground, and we have a momentum exception to in 5.2.A, which would make this a safety, but because of the exception, we just go back where the possession was recovered, which our beanbag tells us is at the 2-yard line, and that becomes the basic spot. The 2-yard line is also the basic spot for any PSK fouls that occurred during the down. So if Team R commits a holding violation,
violation while this kick is in the air, and that holding violation occurs up near the line of scrimmage. Then we have the basic spot on this play being the 2-yard line. We have a penalty that is a 10-yard foul, and it's half the distance of the goal. We put the ball at the 1-yard line, and it would be Team R's ball, first and 10, from that spot. We've covered a lot here. We've talked about the exception in 8-5-2, and we've also talked about PSK foul, which we're going to get into more maybe in the offseason on a PSK special video. And in that video, I'm also going to introduce what I call BSI. And that's where you rename your beanbag to a BSI. And a BSI just means that it's a basic spot indicator. Because every time you throw the beanbag, you're indicating a basic spot. That's why in Federation, we never throw a beanbag when Team A loses possession behind their line of scrimmage. But we'll talk more about that. And I've also got a special treat for you. So more coming up on that a little bit later on. But that's what I wanted to cover in this play, and as we let it go, this player just ends up throwing the ball out beyond the 4-yard line, and this crew rules this a safety, which we already know could not happen in National Federation of High School rules. Couldn't happen in the NCAA, too, but they missed this knee on the ground. But a good play to talk about, a good time to review the momentum exceptions, and a good time to mention post-scrimmage kick fouls. As we cover, there's a lot to do on these kick plays. You know, I always talk about 22 guys spread out all across the field with 5 officials. We got to do the very best we can, but having some basic fundamental understanding of the momentum rule and PSK fouls makes it a lot easier whenever you try to officiate any type of a kick play. All right, let's take a look at this play. And the reason I want to show you this one is the quarterback just fakes a handoff up the middle and then comes to the near side here running with the ball. And the reason I want to show you this action here, and the ball does come out and the defense recovers it, so we get a question about whether this is a targeting foul or potential targeting foul. And the first thing I want to do is eliminate this player as defenseless, because a runner already in the grasp of a tackler whose forward progress has been stopped is a defenseless player. So I think the question becomes here whether his forward progress has been stopped, and I don't see any evidence of that on the video. So I do not think this is a defenseless player, although he is a quarterback. He is merely a runner at this stage of the game. So we take a look at this in slow motion, and I want you to notice the defender's helmet completely covering in the video, completely covering up the quarterback's helmet before we see any movement vertically of the quarterback's head. And I think that's what gives us a clear indication here that this is not a targeting foul, that the contact is on the shoulder pads or in the chest area. And we got a chance to talk about this as a staff and pass this around this week, and it is very, very close. We do not rule a targeting foul on this play on the field, and our video does support that. So I wanted to take a look at this from a couple of different angles, and just to show you what this looks like at full speed when we have a play that's close but it's not a targeting foul. And so great job by this crew of correctly not calling targeting on this play, but I think it's a good one to watch, to look at, study head movement. And also, I'm sure the sound of this was different. You didn't hear that crack of a helmet when we have helmet-to-helmet contact. So all of these things you have to weigh in a split second that you make the decision. The other important thing about calling targeting fouls is I do think before you throw your flag, it is a great idea to process this play in your head. Give yourself a few seconds to process the play. And on this particular one, you have that time, because the play ends. So you can blow your whistle and come crashing in, and while you're doing that, you can process this play in your head. And if you do know that you have targeting foul, a flag that's slightly late here is okay. Because when I look at this on tape, I can see the officials actually replaying that play in their head to make sure that they understand what they saw. Give your brain a little time to process these plays. But this crew, great job, correctly officiated here. This is not a targeting foul. All right, let's take a look at this play. And this is a pulling guard, and big number 75 is going to come through the B gap on the opposite side here and lead the runner into the second level. And linebacker number 20 here goes low and upends this big lineman. So I want to go back to this play, and I want to talk about one thing. Do we understand what blocking below the waist is? And that's in 2.3.7, and it just says that blocking below the waist is making initial contact below the waist from the front or the side against an opponent other than the runner. Contact with opponent's hands below the waist that continues into the body below the waist is considered blocking below the waist. Blocking below the waist applies only when the opponent has one or both feet on the ground. So this clearly is a block below the waist. It's outside the free blocking zone. The ball's outside the zone. The block's not initially at the snap. So there's just absolutely no way to put this as a legal block. And we don't see the defenders blocking low below the waist very often, but we do primarily see it against a pulling guard or against some other official who is out in front of the runner into the second level. So that should have been a red flag for us when this play happens. And who has the best shot of this? We know this player is primarily the key for the umpire, and it's right in the area where the umpire is looking. So I do expect the umpire to get this call. Who also has a shot at this is the referee, because the quarterback's not in any jeopardy here. So the referee should have already transitioned to the point of attack. And referees, you should be ahead of the ball carrier, looking up at the block immediately in front of him. Back judge, I would expect you to be at some other location. You should have also transitioned to run play on this, though. But I would expect you to be looking at this inside block in the primary gap. But I do think that you have a chance to get this if there's absolutely nothing there and your focus does come out to this lead block. But I don't hold you as the primary on this, nor the referee. I do think it's secondary for the referee, and I just think it's a great opportunity for a back judge, if you were able to process this, to save the crew. But we hang this no call directly on the umpire. And what I mean about potentially saving the crew is you should never ever leave your primary key when there is a potential for a foul to transition to help another official, especially someone who's not out of position. So your focus needs to primarily be on your keys, but if you do transition and pick up these fouls, we would appreciate you saving the crew. So we've got a couple of different chances here to catch this foul, but we don't get it. So my focus is, do we understand blocking below the waist can be on either offense or defense? And like I mentioned here, we do primarily see these block below the waist by the defense on these pulling guard type plays, or any time that the lead blocker is at the second level and gets cut. So we do need to recognize that. We need to have red flags up. We should have a heightened sense of alert anytime we see a blocker out in front of the runner going to the second level. But this is an improper no call for the umpire, improperly officiated this play for an illegal block below the waist against the defense. That's it for this week. I got one more play, but I just don't have time to get to it. I need about 6 minutes for this next play. It's a kickoff play. We'll start with that one next week. I do have one question, though, that I got this week I wanted to touch on real quick. And this involved an ineligible A player downfield who catches a forward pass. And was that offensive pass interference? Someone can correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe that rule changed about a decade ago. So now it's not eligibility that determines pass interference on the offense. It is actually just the act. What did the player do? So the litmus test for what is or what's not pass interference is identical for an eligible A player or an ineligible A player. Of course, it is illegal touching an ineligible player downfield if he's beyond the neutral zone expanded. We talked about that last week. So, and I guess that's what brought that question up, but a great question, and I appreciate getting that. Hope that cleared it up for you. ToddAllen65@gmail.com is my email address. If you have questions, comments, things you'd like to say, I love hearing from you and hearing about your crew and what's going on. I appreciate all the emails. If I didn't answer your email, I did read every one of them that I got, but some of them I may not have answered. And lots of comments below too, which I should mention. We're approaching 2,000 subscribers to this channel. I would appreciate you subscribing if you haven't already. And I also failed to mention, on September the 9th, we put out a training video on exactly the same date from our first video 10 years ago. So 10 years we've been producing these videos, and they're worthless unless you watch them. What makes them valuable is the time you spend with the video and with your crew working to get better. That's what makes the whole deal work. So thank you very much for that, for the Arkansas Association of High School Officials. This is Todd Allen saying I hope to see you on the field real soon.